Luke 19, verses 11 through 27, it says, "Now as they heard these things, he," Jesus, "spoke another parable, because he was near Jerusalem, and," this is important, "because they thought the kingdom of God would appear immediately. Therefore, he said, a certain nobleman went into a far country to receive for himself a kingdom and to return. So he called 10 of his servants and delivered to them 10 minas." Again, a mina was a coin that had a certain worth. Different commentators will tell you different amounts, but it was a modest amount, really. It wasn't a huge sum of money, but it was an endowment that they received of money for a particular purpose. So he called 10 of his servants and delivered to them a total of 10 minas and said to them, "Do business till I come." And you don't want to miss that either, that commandment, "Do business till I come." Some other verses might say, King James Version says, "Occupy till I come." But the idea is, maintain yourselves occupied and busy with a purpose in mind, with a purposeful mind. "Do business till I come." But his citizens hated him and sent a delegation after him, saying, "We will not have this man to reign over us." And so it was that when he returned, having received the kingdom, he then commanded the servants to whom he had given the money to be called to him, that he might know how much every man had gained by trading. Then came the first, saying, "Master, your mina has earned 10 minas." And he said to him, "Well done, good servant, because you were faithful in a very little, have authority over 10 cities." And the second came, saying, "Master, your mina has earned 5 minas." Likewise, he said to him, "You also be in authority over 5 cities." Then another came, saying, "Master, here is your mina, which I have kept put away in a handkerchief, for I feared you, because you are an austere man." It's a fancy word for severe, serious, not to be taken lightly. "You are an austere man. You collect what you did not deposit and reap what you did not sow." And he said to him, "Out of your own mouth I will judge you, you wicked servant. You knew that I was an austere man, collecting what I did not deposit and reaping what I did not sow. Why then did you not put my money in the bank, that at my coming I might have collected it with interest?" And he said to those who stood by, "Take the mina from him and give it to him who has 10 minas. For I say to you that to everyone who has will be given, and from him who does not have, even what he has will be taken away from him. But bring here those enemies of mine who do not want me to reign over them, and slay them before me." You know, this is the kind of passage that can be kind of scandalous, especially that ending, to minds that have not been treated by the gospel. And that can be shocking to those who have a very simplistic understanding of Jesus as pure, undiluted meekness and love and gentleness and kind of an undemanding personality. And the entire dynamic of this passage, there seems to be a kind of an element of, you know, injustice. If we look at it from a purely human perspective, I mean, it is saturated with a kind of ethos and outlook that is very, I think, even repugnant to the secular mind with its understandings of what justice is, fairness, mercy, compassion, all of these things that we associate with the gospel, really. It's a totally counterintuitive text that we have here, and made more uncomfortable by the fact that it is about Jesus himself. and about the Christian life and the calling to the gospel. And we are all implicated in it. That makes it even more uncomfortable. But the fact is that this text, if we take it seriously, is capable of at the very least, putting upside down some of the simplistic understandings that we have of Jesus and of the gospel, and moving us to really become much more complex in the way we interpret what it really means to be a Christian and to please God and to fulfill the mandate of being a full-fledged disciple of Christ, because that is the intention of this text. And that's precisely why I like it. Not because I'm a sadist trying to spoil your life this morning, but really because I think it's, you know, when we are made uncomfortable, then the Holy Spirit can do certain things in our life. And, you know, I think this culture that we live in and Christianity, the Christianity that we kind of experience daily, as Leroy was saying, you know, it is sometimes a pale reflection, really, a diluted expression of this pure, robust, complex Christianity that I see portrayed in Scripture every page that I turn, practically. That's why I love the gospel. That's why I love Christianity. Not because it puts me to sleep and lulls me into a false sense of peace and rest, but really because it makes me, you know, it makes me uncomfortable. It pushes me to be something better, to see life in a mysterious, complex way as it is, and to see God in all his richness and all his multifaceted way of being. And this is what that's what we have here, you know, because evidently, you know, we have here a noble man in the parable who is an incarnation of Jesus. Really, it is Jesus, the Son of Man, who is carrying out certain things. We have these servants who are really a reflection of us. They are meant to be expressions of each believer, really. And we have the dynamic of the gospel, this noble man who goes to a faraway country. What is that faraway country? Heaven, of course. And so you see the whole gospel here being treated in a very complicated, complex, uncomfortable sort of way. This meditation is in line with what I have been preaching in the past few Sundays, as we have had some services together. You may have missed some pieces of it, and, you know, Greg preaches here. And by the way, Greg is in California with his family. That's why he's not here this morning. So he's enjoying a little bit of time away, which he so deserves. But, you know, the Lord put in my heart at the very beginning of the year to concentrate this year significantly on this idea of consolidation, consolidating the truths that God has spoken to our church, both English and Spanish, over the last few years. Because I believe that as we have finished our new sanctuary, which I think is something that was in God's heart, we are now initiating a new stage of life. And as I see you this morning, I'm so filled with absolute enthusiasm about what God can do in this city. And I know that he has great things for us. And so I wanted to, instead of just going into some sort of heady, enthusiastic, journey into all new things, into the unknown, to say, you know, before we do that, let's look back a bit and meditate on the things that God has spoken to us, those foundational things that we need to always keep in mind before we enter into the journey of the new, you know, Canaan and the new land that God has before us. And so this idea of the gospel, one of the things that I wanted to kind of root us in is, you know, the idea that the gospel is beautiful, it's joyous, it's fulfilling, it's prosperity and blessing and healing, but it is also sacrifice. It is also investing in the kingdom. It is also yielding our lives to the Lord. It is also experiencing the cross that purifies us and cleanses us and breaks us and kills us before it gives us new life. And, you know, you need to meet the gospel at that juncture of those two things, the Friday of crucifixion, if you will, and the Sunday of resurrection. We need the two. And sometimes I believe that in our enthusiasm for the prospect of grace and love and so on and so forth, we have kind of, you know, shoved under the rug the other side, the justice, the truth of the gospel. And we need to have both of them together. And so I've been meditating on that, and I think this passage is ideal for that kind of focus. So that, you know, the Christian life is something, what we see here in this atmosphere that is established in this text, the Christian life is something of immense weight and significance. We come into it not only to receive from God, but especially to give to Him as well, to serve Him and the purposes of His kingdom. The gospel is it's a coherent mechanism. It's like those old watches where, you know, these little pieces, all of them have to work in concert with each other. And if one breaks down, the others cannot function. It's a closed system. And the gospel is like that. It's extremely complex. It's made up of many, many truths. And our goal should be to know and to ingest and internalize as many of those truths and to keep them in tension within our soul. Sometimes they will be in tension. Because even here, when we see Jesus Christ portrayed in a very severe kind of way, I can show you other passages where He is, you know, pure mercy, forgiveness, compassion, tolerance, acceptance. And woe is to us if we extract or extricate one piece of the revelation of the fullness of Christ's personality, and we kind of make believe that we didn't see it. We kind of put it in, you know, a minor place, and we just emphasize one thing. What we're doing is really we're shortchanging ourselves. We're not allowing the gospel to function as that perfect coordinated mechanism that God designed it to be. And so my call this morning is for us to experience, you know, the fullness of Christ's personality and calling, and to see Him for a moment in that severe, austere modality that we see Him here in this text. We must contrast the kind of atmosphere that is established in this text with that, you know, kind of easy gospel that is so prevalent today, that cheap grace that is preached in so many different forms, which is a distortion ultimately of the word of that Jesus preached and taught. My contention is that God, He does want to bless us. And by the way, I don't want you for a moment to interpret these sermons that I've been preaching, these meditations, as, you know, some sterile, dry call to duty and to law and to works and to kind of, you know, just lashing ourselves for our sins. It's not about that. What keeps me tethered to the gospel is this, you know, this call that God gives to each of His children to a fulfilling life, a life of joy, deep joy. Not the easy gladness that we think about sometimes, but joy, fulfillment, a sense of purpose, reconciliation with God, kind of being rooted in that centeredness, that we know who God is and that we have peace with Him. And we know that our life is secure in Him, that no matter what happens in our life, it's okay because God is in control. That as the Word says, you know, all things that happen to those who love God, they work out for good. And that kind of certainty, that kind of rootedness in God and the willingness to go through the whole process of breaking and dying to self and the service and holiness yields, if it's done right, if it's not, you know, distorted into works and law and religion and duty, if it's not turned into that, it yields happiness and fulfillment and joy and blessing and prosperity, even material blessing, because I do believe that God wants to prosper us and bless us as well. But it has to be done the right way. God does not want to just bless and prosper us, though, but only He does want to do that, but only when we give Him our all, when we have totally accepted His lordship over every area of our life, which is, I think, what this establishes here. When we serve Him wholeheartedly, when we have accepted the fact that we need to die to self and live for Him who redeemed and purchased us through His death on the cross. You know, you can choose who owns you, whether it is Satan and the world or Jesus Christ. You have to choose what yoke and what burden you will carry in life. I mean, every one of us has to carry some yoke. We are all under some sort of authority. And you have to choose whether the authority of the world and the devil or Jesus Christ, who said, my yoke is, what is it, light, my burden is light, my yoke is easy. It's not that easy, but it is easy, ultimately, when you know how to carry it. When you know how to carry it. But you have to, there's no, you have to choose. You always have to choose. There is no neutrality in this world that we inhabit. Which yoke, which system you are going to be under. That's all. And one yields life and blessing and joy. The other yields death, dryness, and failure. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 19 and 20 says, the Apostle Paul, or do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have from God, and you are not your own? I don't own myself. I don't belong. You know, this insistence sometimes of secular culture of independence, you know, my body is my own, my mind is my own, my home is my own, my work is my own. It is not your own. You have been made by God. You're a creature of God. You are totally dependent of God. If God took his eye away from you, in a moment you would just crumble into dust. The thoughts with which you carry out your life and you trade and you do things are they are woven by God. So even as you process things, it is enabled by the sustaining spirit that is God. And you have to acknowledge that. So you are not your own. For you were bought at a price, says the Apostle Paul. You were bought at a price. Jesus bought. If you're a Christian and you are living under that framework of Christianity, you were bought. You were purchased. Your salvation, your relationship with God, your intimacy with God, your expectation of eternal life, that was bought at a price. The blood of Christ, the body of Christ broken for our sins. And the conclusion of the apostle is, therefore, glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. That means that you can't live, you know, and do whatever you want. Even my distortions, even my brokenness, even the things that I abhor about myself, I mean, they are God's, so I have to yield them to him to deal with it. You know, I cannot say, well, you know, this is the way I am. This is the way God made me. You know, some people can do that. No, God made us to be whole. And God's intention is that we be cleansed and sanctified by Jesus Christ. So whatever it is, whatever area of my life does not conform to God's intentions, I'm going to yield it to him. Because if my body belongs to him, my mind belongs to him, my wife belongs to him, my children belong to him, ministry belongs to him, everything that I am. That is the distinctive nature of Christian mentality. And again, I'm here. I haven't yet entered fully, you know, directly into the text. But this is all this atmosphere of the text is established by, you know, by or rather what I'm saying is rooted in what we have just read. This purpose of Jesus' parable. Why does Jesus give this parable? It says that that his disciples had an overly optimistic understanding of his ministry. They thought, oh, he's going to Jerusalem. That means he's going to declare his messiahship, finally. He's going to come before the authorities and finally announce in power and glory and absolute authority, I am the Messiah. And then what he will do, they thought in their easy understanding of who Christ was, they thought, oh, he's now going to return the glory to Israel again. The same glory that Israel enjoyed when David was the king, now he's going to do it. And everything will be beautiful, and we will return to all, and he will kick the Romans out, and everybody will live happily ever after. You know, people always tend to oversimplify the complexity of God's plans. They didn't even realize that there were 2,000 years of history still ahead, and God knows how many more, before, you know, God's plan would be fully realized. So Jesus says, you know, as the good teacher that he is, rather than kind of, you know, playing on with their wrong understanding, he says, wait a minute, guys, if you're following me, you got to get your understanding together of who I am. So he tells this parable in order to correct this enthusiasm, this unrealistic enthusiasm. So the parable is meant to kind of bring soberness. That's what I mean. You know, we're always trying to do that. We're always trying to oversimplify. We always want the blessing without the cross, without the process. God had a process that he wanted his son to follow, and he wanted the world to follow. And his understanding of Jesus' role was so much wider than they contemplated. It wasn't just to bless Israel. It was to bless humanity. It was to bless centuries of human history and to enact a beautiful drama that would take hundreds of years. And in all its complexity, it would ultimately bring glory to God. Because that's what it is. History is, this mass of interactions and processes all glorifying God and declaring His sovereignty and His lordship. So God wasn't just after some quick result. He was into process. And Jesus wanted to correct that. So he gives this story of this man, this noble man, it's an allusion to himself, who goes away to a far country, and already you get a sense. This is going to take time, folks. He goes to a faraway country. And he says, and he gives his servants, each one of them, an endowment of money. And he charges to them. He says, now, do business. The word that is used in the Greek original is pragmateousaste, which means it's a command. And I was looking it up at a definition, looking at a definition of it. And this is one definition from a lexicon. It says, the word pragmateousaste, or it comes from the verb pragmateuomai, says, that verb, occupy, do business, denotes the conducting of business, especially that of a banker or a trader. This more specific meaning seems to be intended in this parable. Pragmateuomai carries with it the idea of doing diligent business or trading, expending great energy and effort in producing great results, not just spending one's time casually working at something. You know, the gospel is full of purpose. The gospel is a serious thing. This whole atmosphere here is infused with a business mentality. This nobleman is an executive. He's a chief executive officer. He calls his employees together. He gives them a certain amount to invest, and he says, okay, guys, I am delegating to you now. Like a good corporate CEO, he doesn't tell them all the, he doesn't micromanage. He just gives them the guiding values, the core values, and he says, make money for me. You know, I don't care how you do it. That's not really, we have to do it according to the values. But he says, I'm not going to tell you specifically how to do it, but you have been given an endowment. Now I'm going away. I don't know for how long. While I'm away, I expect you to invest what I have given you and to use it wisely. And when I come back, you and I are going to talk and we're going to see what you have done with what I have given you. Are you starting to get it? This is, one of the things that really impacts me about this text is precisely that. It is the sense of seriousness, severity, clear directives, clear expectations, and also clear consequences if we don't give what the Lord is expecting of us. How many of us, can include those elements into our understanding of the gospel? That, I have been given something and I have been created for a purpose and it's an extreme responsibility. I can't just live my life lackadaisically, casually. Oh, God is good. He understands me. He understands my limitations. He's generous. Grace. It's much more than that. It's a very serious thing. And to me, instead of impoverishing the gospel, that just adds substance and texture to it. There is a process that God has designed. This is what Jesus is clarifying here. There has to be something that needs to be done according to the assignment that the Lord gives. And when you do that, then you can enter fully into the joy of the Lord and the blessing of God. There's a measure of blessing that we can all achieve just and receive through the blood of Jesus Christ. But if you really want to experience the fullness of joy of the gospel, you got to pay the price. You got to work. What you were saying, Leroy, earlier, even to rest, it takes effort. We've been too casual in the way we understand. There is work involved. Before we can enter into the full enjoyment of God's blessings, we have to follow a process of self-purification, sanctification, consecration to God's purpose and service, obedience to His will. We must study His word find out what does God want from me, and then to the best of our ability, illuminated by the Holy Spirit, and with the great help of God, because you don't have to do it alone, that's the good thing, and with His great patience, love, mercy, as you try to do His will, and you fail time and time again like I do, and you are frustrated with your utter inability, but God says, no, as long as you're engaged, as long as you're doing the best that you can, as long as you are seeking my grace and seeking to please me, that's all I want. I'm going to work with you. I'm not going to leave you. But you have to do it. So there's work involved. There's investment. There is business involved in the gospel. I think of the words of the apostle in 2 Timothy 2. Paul says to Timothy, you therefore, Timothy, this young pastor, you must endure hardship as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. That's a call to you, my brother, my sister, to myself. You know, there's an element of hardship, but that's the glory of the gospel right there. It's not all hardship. It's joy, it's blessing. That's why I'm in this thing. And I'll continue until the day I die, because I can't find any better alternative to the kingdom than serving the Lord with all my heart, all my mind. And experiencing times of stress, exhaustion, doubt, but also at times of extreme joy and of knowing that, wow, God made something very beautiful. And His intention is to do something extraordinary through my life. And Paul continues saying to Timothy, no one engaged in warfare entangles himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who enlisted him as a soldier. Image of soldiery and military. And says, and also if anyone competes in athletics, another image, the athlete, he is not crowned unless he competes according to the rules. Why do many of us not experience greater joy in our life, blessing? It's because we're not competing. We're not running the race legitimately, as Paul says. We are cutting corners. We are trying to oversimplify things. We're ignoring God's directions. I want to encourage us all. Let's take God seriously. What He says in His Word is precise. And if we follow it precisely, it will yield life and blessing. And so if we compete according to the rules, we will be crowned. And finally, He uses the image of the farmer. He says, the hardworking farmer must be first to partake of the crops, because there is joy, there is reward in doing things God's way, and investing in His kingdom, and working for Him. Consider what I say, and may the Lord give you understanding in all things. So Jesus tells them the parable to teach these innocent crowd that expects just easy money, that no, guys, this is more complex. It's going to take time. It's going to take effort. It's going to take obedience. It's going to take patience. It's going to take systematic work with a purpose in mind. It's going to take that God has given you something, and now you must live your whole life seeking to enhance it and increase it and use it for the benefit of God's kingdom. So here are some conclusions that I want to clarify for all of us through this passage. Number one, what you see here in this passage is we are all given a gift. Each servant in this passage receives a measure, an endowment, a coin. It could have been anything, $1,000, $100,000, it doesn't matter. The point of the parable is that each of them was given a capacity. When we receive the Holy Spirit, if you have received Christ as your Savior, if the Holy Spirit has come into your life, with the Holy Spirit has come God's power, life, and endowment. So each of us receives an endowment of power and gifting. Don't say that God didn't give you anything, because God always, He's a giver of gifts. If you're in the kingdom, you have a gift. You have something God has put in you. 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 7. For I wish that all men were even as myself. But each one has his own gift from God. One in this manner and another in that manner. 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 10 and 11. As each one has received a gift, minister it to one another as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. Read that passage later on if you can. So, I mean, the Bible is full of references to the fact that, you know, if you are in the kingdom, God has given his power to you. He's given you a calling. You have something. You have a purpose. And now that you're in the kingdom, you want to ask the Holy Spirit, teach me, show me, what is it that you have put into my life? And how can I serve you? Many of us don't find our gift because we just don't know that we have it, number one. And number two, we don't really engage in trying to discover it. We could go on and on as to how to do that. You do that by becoming involved in the life of the people of God. You can begin serving in small things, around menial things. Begin humbly. And then as you continue, God says, if you are faithful in the little things, God will put you in the big things. One day, you will be right in the center of what God has for you. But you got to start somewhere. You can't just ask for the Lord, oh, give me revelation out of nowhere. Give me a dream, Lord. Send an angel to tell me. No, you have to assume that it is there and then engage in faith. Occupy until you receive that fullness of what God has given you. So assume that you have something very beautiful. Don't let anybody tell you that you have nothing to give. You have something. God has put value in you. Number two, this passage tells us that we are expected by God to use the gift that he has given us and to enhance it, to return it to God increased and even multiplied. 2 Timothy chapter 1, verses 6 and 7, the Apostle Paul says to Timothy again, therefore I remind you to stir up the gift of God, which is in you, see again, it's in you, through the laying on of hands. For God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. So we're expected. I mean, there's many references. And you see in this passage that we're dealing with here, that every one of these men who was given a gift, and of course this extends to women and, you know, everybody who's in the kingdom of God, just the imagery of the time, you know, they were each given something and they were expected. If they didn't do what they needed to do, there were severe consequences for it. So we are expected to use the gift that God has given us and to enhance it and to return it to God increased and even multiplied. Number three, if we use this gift, it will increase and we shall receive more. You see, these men had a different attitudes. And so, you know, they almost all of them, they, you know, they went into their assignment and they came back and said, Lord, you know, you gave us something and here we have increased it. You know, sometimes the fear of failure, low self-esteem, a sense of I can't do it, you know, that's for the gifted, that's for the professionals of religion, you know, that's for the holy. You know, no, you know, just enter into the, engage in the assignment by faith. And failure is not a possibility because God is with you. God is, he will use you, but you are expected to use it. And if you do, it will increase and you shall receive more. To him who is given, you know, he shall receive more. If you, and now the other thing is, the fourth thing is, if you don't use the gift, as so many believers do, because they don't feel, you know, that's not something that I have to do. I just simply report to church, and I drop a $20 bill in the best of cases many times into the plate. Then I go home, and I punched my, you know, my card, and that's it. It's not like that. If you don't use the gift, because it's in you, it will stagnate, and it'll become a stumbling block in your life. Ultimately, it incurs a measure of displeasure on the part of God. Stagnant Christians, unproductive Christians, don't please the Lord. That is the truth. I mean, he loves you, but he's not pleased with us. You know, we should be pursued by that restlessness. Lord, am I doing what I'm supposed to be doing? You know, you remember the parable of the fig tree? It says that Jesus came one day in his walk, daily walk through, you know, ministry. He sees this fig tree, and, you know, the fig tree is full of leaves, very promising. But when he went to find fruit in the fig tree, he didn't find anything. It was all leaves. It reminded him of this nation of Israel, so gifted and so unproductive for the kingdom, so rebellious. and probably reminded him of all those Christians throughout the ages who were going to be very promising. I mean, there's so much gifting in the Church of Christ. I mean, everyone has a gift, and some of us are placed in positions where we could do incredible things for the kingdom, but we're unproductive. We're clueless as to the fact that God expects us. And therefore, that's why, you know, the Holy Spirit is grieved, and we cannot enter into the fullness because, you know, the Holy Spirit is encouraged as you try to do something. As you move in with fear and trembling and sometimes stumbling, but God is glorified and pleased. And he says, come on, continue, my son. In that stumbling, in that failing, in that hesitation, I am glorified. I will bless you, and I will give you ultimate reward and fulfillment. So, you know, we enter into it. And as we use it, it increases. And if we don't use it, it stagnates and incurs a displeasure. That's why Jesus was angry at this fig tree. You know, it's a symbol of every unproductive believer. So God's reaction to our unproductivity is not neutral. There's a consequence to it. The fifth thing, there are no excuses. There is always something we can do with the gift that is in us, even if it is small. You know, the master here is not displeased because one yields tenfold and the other yields fivefold. He's just displeased because one of them didn't work anything out. There's a measure. You know, not everybody is gifted the same way. Not everybody is gifted in the same degree. God gives more gifts to some in his lordship, and it doesn't really matter to him. You know, Billy Graham yielded hundreds of thousands, maybe millions of souls to the kingdom. But you know, every pastor engaged in a small church somewhere in the world, pastoring a small flock, you know, is blessed by the Lord and affirmed. It doesn't matter ultimately the magnitude. It is simply the proportion, what we do with the small measures of gifting or larger measures of gifting that God has given us. Romans chapter 2, verse 3 says, "For I say, through the grace given to me, to everyone who is among you, not to think of themselves more highly," and I would add more lowly, "than he ought to think, but to think soberly, as God has dealt to each one a measure of faith. For as we have many members in one body, but all the members do not have the same function, so we, being many, are one body in Christ and individually members of one another." And then he proceeds to give different directions. You know, if you've been gifted in leadership, then lead. If you've been gifted in teaching, then teach. If you've been gifted with money and you have the capacity to distribute, well, distribute it generously and without pride and without making people feel indebted to you. In whatever way it is, you know, whatever service, whatever it is, just do it. Serve the Lord. And just do something with what you have been given. So, conclusions, we've all been given a gift. We are expected to use this gift. If we use the gift, it increases. If we don't use it, it stagnates and becomes a stumbling block. There are no excuses. Number six, if we engage in using and developing our gift, and I've alluded to this already, there's no possibility of failure. Each servant who engaged in work succeeded in some measure. I love Philippians chapter 2, verses 12 and 13. Because it talks about the tensions and the complexity of the gospel. It says, "Therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling, for it is God who works in you both to will and to do for his good pleasure." If God assigns you something, he gives you the grace to fulfill it. Now, it means also that you have to work out, you know, your own service. There's an effort involved here, but God guarantees that the result will always be success. So don't be intimidated by your limitations, your sinfulness, the place you are in life right now. Don't worry about it. God loves to deal with our limitations and to glorify himself by leading us to full success ultimately. Number seven, I got three more, and that's it. God does not expect all of us to be equally successful. All he expects is effort and investment in what he has given us. Tenfold, fivefold. Probably one of those 10 guys only gave him twice what he gave. But as long as there was some degree of profit, that's all that he wanted. So he doesn't expect you to do, you know, great, great miracles. He expects you to be faithful. Number eight, when Jesus returns again, and he will return. This is the whole thing about this text. We realize, you know, yes, Jesus went to a faraway place. He's sitting at the right hand of God, so to speak. But he is coming again. And each of us, you know, sometimes we think that the throne, the judgment seat is only for sinners. Well, it says that all of us must come before the throne of God to give an account of what we have done, whether it is good or bad. There's going to be an evaluation. I don't know how it's going to be done. Is it going to be virtual? Is it going to be bodily? I don't know. God's going to have some computer that we kind of plug to, and all of us will experience the same degree of judging. I don't know, but there will be a measuring of what we have done. You know, which also leads into another thing about the complexity of heaven. Because here, these men are given, say, authority over 10 cities, 5 cities, supposedly after he returns. You know, what's going to happen in heaven? So we have this, and this stuff sometimes governs our passiveness when we serve the Lord. We think that heaven is going to be, you know, when you get there, they're going to give you a one-size-fits-all bathrobe and a harp, and you're going to go to some cloud, and you're going to be there playing music. What a boring prospect. I mean, if that's what God wants to give me, that's fine, but I think he has so much more. I think heaven is going to be a very dynamic place. It's going to be a place of work, but not with the kind of, you know, nastiness of work here in the world. It's going to be a place of great enterprise and undertaking great things for God. I don't know what it is. I'm not even going to hazard a guess as to what it is, but there's going to be great difference in heaven. And there's going to be dynamic investment and energy and differences of stature and glory and power and authority. I want to get as much as I can here on earth now. Invest as much as I can. So when I get there, you know, my condo is going to be at least 3 or 4 bedrooms. I don't know. But I want to do as much as I can. What the word says, you know, create for yourselves treasures here. There's nothing wrong with being, you know, a little selfish about heaven. You know, if only we knew that, yeah, there's going to be different degrees of glory. Different degrees of enjoyment, perhaps even, of God's full presence. It's not one size fits all. That's not the, you know, that's not the way I see Jesus talking about that dimension. So what we do here has implications for what we receive when we get there. Another thing, our salvation, by the way, this is a clarification here. Our salvation does not depend on our works according to the law. I'm not saying that you will be saved because of what you do here or not do. Jesus Christ saves us. Belief in Christ, commitment to Christ, placing our dependency on him and our faith on him. But, you know, this is the complexity of grace versus works. And the thing is this, because we're lulled into just kind of, you know, false dichotomies, that the two are put together. Once we are saved, we are expected to give evidence of our salvation through our works. See, you're not going to be saved by your works, but if you are truly saved and you are endowed by the Holy Spirit and you have the energy of the Holy Spirit, then there is no way that you will not do something. It's like, you know, light not dispelling darkness. The definition of light is it dispels darkness. Its work is to dispel darkness. It's nature. When you are given a nature by God, that nature will express itself somehow. So that's the complexity of the gospel. You know, as James says, there's no such a thing as faith without works. Faith always does something. And when James wrote that text, it was really to correct that tendency to oversimplify the gospel and to just stress grace so much that you forget that, no, God expects product from me as well. I gotta make some effort. And if I am truly a child of God and I have a gift, I have to stir it into manifestation. And I gotta do all that I can to use it for the glory of God. And, you know, it is both work out your own salvation, but God is the one who works it out with you and for you. Finally, and all God's people say amen. Number 10, kingdom business is serious business. That's all I want to leave with you. And I'm going to invite Roy and Chantel to come forward, the worship team, just quickly. Your kingdom business, my brothers and my sisters, is serious business. Jesus Christ is not to be taken lightly. We revel in His love. We revel in His blessing. We rejoice in His extreme generosity for us. I am more in love with Christ now than ever when I first met Him and knew Him. I would not trade the Christian life for anything else. It's full of joy and celebration and blessing. He has given me so much more than I deserve or expected. But it is a serious business, not to be taken lightly. The complexity of God's character is immense. Let me ask you a question. How seriously are you taking God, Jesus Christ, and your Christian life? How seriously am I taking my ministry, my life? Do I just expect God to fulfill all of my needs, and that's all? Am I overcome with this sense of the seriousness, the holiness of this God that I serve? Am I seeking to bear fruit for the glory of God always? That's what I want to invite you to do this morning. That's the purpose of my exertions this morning. Just to soberly ask us to consider this gracious God who has given you and I more than we deserve. And He is inviting us into a journey, a quest that is profound, noble, exalted. He wants you to live out your Christian life as an immense gift, where he wants to bring you to the stature of a hero or heroine, a knight in shining armor, a man or a woman in a quest for self-development, in growing in dignity, growing in knowledge of God and Christ, aware of the purpose that God created you for, being used of God to bless your community, bless your family, bless those around you, secure others to come into salvation. I mean, wonderful, wonderful things. Let us not miss out on that opportunity to serve this austere, this incredibly holy God. And I invite you to do that this morning. Would you lower your head for a moment, or whatever you want as a sign of focusing on that truth this morning, and say, Lord, I will serve you. Lord, I'm willing to sacrifice myself in order to receive more of you. I thank you because Jesus paid the full price, but now I want to enter into that. You know, if you haven't found from life all that you desired 20 years ago, 10 years ago, 5 years ago, maybe you had dreams. There were things that you thought that life was going to give you. They didn't materialize. You know, don't give up hope. Just enter into the plan of God. Enter into His prescription. Follow the rules. Follow the system that God has established. Give yourself to Him. Sacrifice whatever it is. Give up whatever it is that God is asking of you, even if it's something that you love and value greatly. And you think, why should I give this up? If God says it, do it. Put aside your fears of failure and of, you know, living a stale life because you've given something that is very nice and pleasant. No, give it to the Lord. Pay the price. Commit yourself to living out the Christian life fully. And I guarantee you fulfillment and blessing and joy and greatness. So thank you, Father. This morning, we yield to you. Father, we commit to living out the Christian life legitimately in all its complexity. We ask forgiveness for many times turning it into something that it is not meant to be. I bless my brothers and sisters this morning. I pray that none of this will sound to them like stale, sterile law, but that it would really be that invitation to greatness and fulfillment that it is, through Jesus Christ and His Holy Spirit. Would you ask Jesus to come into your life if you haven't done it yet this morning? Would you say, Lord, come into my life? And if you have done it already, say, Lord, come in more fully. I yield my life to you. You have purchased my life through your blood and through your death on the cross. I open my heart and my spirit to you this morning. Jesus Christ, come in. Forgive me for not having done it earlier. or for having cheated myself by not giving all of myself to you. But today I do it, Lord. I yield myself to you. Come, Jesus. Come into my life. And if you have done that this morning, then I invite you to come to me or to one of our ministers or some of the people that you saw here praying this morning. Draw near to somebody right here and say, listen, I'd like for you to pray with me. Or I don't know what to do now. What is the next stage that I need to follow? And we want to engage with you. We want to walk that walk with you. We want to be a part of that journey. It's going to be a journey of sometimes stumbling, but that's okay. God is committed to you for eternity. You know, he doesn't kick you when you fall. He comes running and picks you up again and rejoices in restoring you. So if you have done that, welcome to the family of God, and I promise you an extraordinary life. In Jesus' name, amen and amen.